international aspects easy to understand. Specialization means if a country can produce better than another country, we say that's specialization. They might use less resources when compared to another country. For example, if I'm producing phone and one country is taking one labor per day to make a phone, and I'm taking if I take two labors, the other country will get specialization because they are just using only one labor when they're producing the product. Now, when you speak about specialization, there are two types of advantages you will get through. One we say that's comparative advantage, other one we say that's absolute advantage. I'm going to take two countries here, most probably as we are in Sri Lanka. I'm going to take Sri Lanka and I'm going to take United Kingdom. Okay? So I'm going to take two countries and I'm going to take two products. I'm going to take TV and I'm going to take radio, something like that. So I'm going to take for one labor, how many labors are used in absolute advantages? I'm going to use some inputs. So when I compare my inputs, which is using the lowest input should be considered when it comes to this. So now I'm going to use input as labor. I'll take output. Output is easy to understand. For your syllabus, it's not A levels, it's very easy to understand. Sri Lanka is producing 5 TVs by using one labor. So one labor can produce 5 output, actually. So then TV radio they are producing 4, and United Kingdom is producing 4, and they are producing 8. So now when I compare these things between these two, Sri Lanka and radio, they are almost like similar. Now in absolute advantage, what we need to understand, you need to understand that in absolute advantage, Sri Lanka is producing higher output than United Kingdom. So Sri Lanka has an absolute advantage than United Kingdom. So I will bold this. Then again, when it comes to radio, who is having the absolute advantage? United Kingdom has the absolute advantage comparison to Sri Lanka. So this is how you find out absolute advantage. Then what is comparative advantage? I'm going to take the same example. Okay. I'm going to take the same example, but the way I'm going to represent, it's going to be different. In comparative advantage, I don't take one labor output. I take it as opportunity cost. Which has the lowest opportunity cost, I will take it. Now, you know the formula of opportunity cost already. Opportunity cost formula speaks about foregone divided by gain, right? So, when I take foregone divided by gain to Sri Lanka, when I produce, let me take this, I take the resource. What am I producing? I'm producing TV and radio, right? TV and radio. So I'm going to write type here, TV and radio. Okay, easy. Now, if I'm producing, I'm going to write the opportunity cost here. If I'm producing 5 TV, I will move on 4 radio under Sri Lanka. So what I will do, first calculation 4 divided by 5 because 4 gone is 4, divided by 5 is now I'm finding the TV's opportunity cost. I'm going to write TV opportunity because OC. 4 divided by 5 will give me a value of how much? 4 divided by 5 will give me a value of, you can find out. It will give me, what is this? Give me a second, Vishali. I'm just checking the number patterns. So it's 0.80. And United Kingdom, when I take the same way, 4 is the gain you are taking. You are going to lose 10. So 10 divided by 4 will give you 2.5. So 10 divided by 4 gone divided by, what do you say? Now I'm going to compare my radio again with the opportunity cost to find. So I will take 4 gone is 5 here when I'm producing radio. 4 I'm gaining, I'm losing 5. So 5 divided by 4, I will get 1.25. I'm going to do the same thing. Now I'm gaining 10, so I'm 4 going into 4, so 4 will come up and 10 come down, so 0.4. So when I compare my opportunity cost, which has the lowest opportunity cost, I will go again. So now if I see here, the lowest opportunity cost in producing TV is Sri Lanka, and lowest opportunity cost in producing, I'm going to compare TV is Sri Lanka, and radio is United Kingdom. So when you compare and if you find the lowest opportunity cost, which country has the lowest opportunity cost, that is what we say comparative advantage. And in the absolute advantage, you need to see which country is producing the highest output. Just revise this anytime so you will be able to understand. So did you understand this part now, guys? next part of the syllabus. Now, as I said, I have spoken about comparative advantage and absolute advantage. A country has an absolute advantage if it can produce a given amount of goods or services with far less resources, and therefore an absolute cost advantage over any country. A country has a comparative advantage in the production of a good or service if it can produce it at a lower opportunity cost related to other countries. So this will not be tested highly in your papers, but it can be tested somewhat in MCQs. So it will be very careful on these particular areas, because these are the areas students doesn't focus much, thinking that it will not be tested. But actually, these are the areas will be tested from 20th to 30th MCQs. So it will be tested. And in paper 2, they will not go that deeper like as I do some charts and showed you, just to have your knowledge on that particular area. So let's move on to the next content. Visible and invisible trade. So what is visible trade? Visible trade is the selling and buying of natural resources, parts and components of goods and production and finished goods. The balance of visible trade, visible exports and visible imports. In easy terms, guys, if I explain you visible means it's goods. So goods, whatever they are selling to the market, we said as visible. Okay, so whatever the goods which they are exchanging as an export and import, we said as visible. In a visible balance of trade, you will have goods, trading goods export and trading goods import. So these goods only they term as visible. So actually, what is the meaning of visible, guys? Visible mean it is goods. Okay, so for knowledge, I'm just writing it down. Visible mean it is goods. Okay. So with that content, we'll move on to the next part. Then what is invisible trade? Invisible trade means, invisible trade is the selling and buying of services. Balance of invisible trade, value of invisible exports minus value of invisible imports. So when they are selling a service, you know, when it comes to export market, if they deliver a service, we say it as invisible export. And whenever they buy some sort of service from outside, we say it as invisible import. So invisible means it's service imports and service exports. So then they have given certain things you need to know, like the basic stuff. Money flows out of the country means it's a bad thing to the economy. Negative impact, it will impact the economy in a bad manner, because your money is going out of the country, it's not good for the country's actual thing. Money flows into the country, positive impact. As money is coming to the country, people can improve their living standard easily. So then if export is higher than imports, aggregate demand increases, because if you can export a lot of things to outside, the demand for the product not only in our country, even from outside, will increase. If export is not that high, you know, and imports are high, then of course the domestic industries, the people who are selling their products inside our country, those products will not be much, it will not have much demand for the products when it sells. So then we move on to the next part, balance of payments, third content of this part. The balance of payment of a country records all financial transactions between the country and all other. It consists of three main accounts. So you need to know a clear idea what's balance of account, balance of payment. So balance of payment is consisting under three parts: current account, capital account, and financial account, which I have given.
Oh, okay, sir.
Balance of payment consists of three types, as I said: current account, capital account, and financial account. Let me see what is under current account. Payment for visible and invisible import and export, plus net income flows and transfers. So if you have a current account, you need to have invisible trade and visible trade. These two things, imports and export, you should consider that. Plus, you need to get the net income flows. So what is net income flows? The money which is flowing into the country. People of our country would have gone to a different country. They might earn an income and they will send that income to our country. When they send that income to our country, then it becomes net income flows. And transfers. What is transfer actually? Some sort of donations you get, some sort of pension they allocate from the government. All these are part of current account. You don't want to know a bit deep again. Just remember what are the parts, components of the current account. So these are the four components. Visible trade, invisible trade, net income flows, and as well as transfers. So capital account means payments involving the sale of capital goods or fixed assets such as buildings and machinery. So if you sell your particular non-current asset stuff, it's a big asset you're going to sell, or if you're going to invest a big asset like a harbor, a road, if you're going to invest in a long-term project, it is a part of capital account. Why government should consider current account, capital account, financial account? The government should know actually at the end of the year, have they made income out of the current account, capital account, and financial account. So when it comes to capital account, as I given you, payments involved in the sale of capital, goods are fixed assets such as building and machinery. So what is financial account? Investment flows including loan and loan repayments and sale of shares. So if you have income, if you can make income, sometimes you might sell your shares to different outside countries. When you sell your share to an outside country, we say as financial account. Why they sell shares? To get some money into the country as investment. Governments does this when they sell treasury bills and treasury bonds. I explain you what treasury bill. Treasury bill means long term, a short term financial need a government can issue as a security towards another country. Treasury bond is a long term security that they will issue not only to the other country, they can even invest now, they can issue in our country also. So when government doesn't have enough income, so when money is inflowing into the country and if money is going out of the country, we need to consider another financial account. But it can be investment. The country can make some investment in another country and get a return of income, or the other countries can invest in our country and they can earn a return of income. So that's what we say at the balance of payment. At the end of the year, balance of payment should be having a good value. And if it is positive, the country is doing so great. If it is negative, the country is in a falling position, like economic recession, or they can even fall into economic decline because they don't have enough money to pay the debts, debts they have taken already. Maybe to uplift the projects like capital account, to build a highway, they took some money from China, for example. If they couldn't pay back that money, those governments can do anything to our government, legitimately or illegitimately. I don't know which they will go through, but our government should understand to pay back the interest what they have taken. If not, they might ask one more step more than the interest. So I don't know what way they will move on. Anyway, we move on to the next part, 8.4, structure of the current account. How does the current account look like? Visible trade account, the difference between the export revenue and import spending on physical goods, car, washing machine. So whatever, as I said, trade account means it is goods what you sell. So whenever you make an income, you need to reduce your import and see how much revenue you have actually made. Then we have the second part, invisible trade account. This is the difference between export revenue from the import spending on services. Like you can deliver services like banking, insurance, tourism, and also you can issue services like warehouse, communication. All these are a part of service. So any type of service they can deliver, they can earn income. Then income flows, interest, profit, and dividends flowing in and out of the country. As I said, people can earn income and they can send from that country to our country. And the last part of the current account is current transfers, grants for overseas aid. So some people can give aid for our government, they can give it freely to our government to uplift our government's situation. Then of course it becomes grants for overseas aid. Balance of payment deficit, why a balance of payment deficit happened and how a balance of payment surplus happened. Let's see, if money flowing in greater than in. So if your money is going out than the money coming in, we say as balance of payment deficit. If money flowing in greater than out, so if money is coming inside the country more than the money which is outflowing, we say as balance of payment surplus. Then they have current plus capital plus financial is negative. So if you have current plus capital financial, maybe one of these is negative, very hugely it can impact the balance of payment, then of course you will get a negative balance. If current plus capital plus financial is positive, then of course you might get a surplus balance. So understanding that point, we will move on to the next part. Trade deficit means people are buying more imports and maybe spending less on products made by domestic firms. Deficit may be a symptom of declining industrial base. Foreign exchange for the national country is likely to fall, increases price of imports and cause imported inflation. So what could happen, like when people have enough income, when they are earning more, they might think that if they can buy branded items from different countries, it's so popular for them and it will give them a higher satisfaction. So what is trade deficit actually? Trade deficit is about when your money is outflowing from your country to outside, then the money inflows into the country, we say as trade deficit. And when this happens, guys, what happens? Domestic firms' products will not be much demanded on the market. Why is that? Because when people are spending on outside part, they will not spend in inside part. They will not buy the products from the inside country. So the domestic firms who are selling the product will not be able to make a sale. So actually, those people will be unemployed and will become a big problem for the huge community. So then the third point, you say foreign exchange for the national currency is likely to fall. When you are over dependent on import, then of course your currency value will go down, it will depreciate because you are so much relied on import and you can't produce anything and you can't sell it, then of course the country will go through a hard time again to come back into the same position. Increases price of import, cause import inflation. When people know that you are relied on import, they will increase their prices, then of course it will affect your economy in a very, like you like it or not, you need to purchase the price at that product at the range what they have given. Give me a second issue. Economy when there's reducing trade deficit. When there's reducing trade deficit, if you wanted to reduce the level of trade deficit in an economy, you need to do certain things. Contractionary fiscal policy by reducing taxes and cutting government expenditure can reduce total demand for imports. Now, when you learn this term, contractionary fiscal policy, you need to understand what is fiscal policy. Fiscal policy speaks about two things, government revenue and government expenditure. So, if you are going to reduce the government expenditure, if you are going to reduce the level of government, you are going to spend in government expenditure and you are going to reduce the government taxes. That's what we say contractionary fiscal policy. Now you see here, by reducing taxes and cutting government expenditure can reduce total demand for import. So you don't motivate people to buy the import. You will try to reduce the level of output and you will, if you can reduce the taxes, people will feel motivated. And if that products, whatever the producing products are in our country, or they can charge higher taxes on the imported product, then of course the demand for import will decrease. They just can do any ways to decrease the level of import. So they will take a necessary step in order to control that. So either you see contraction of fiscal policy by reducing taxes and cutting government expenditure can reduce total demand for import. So this can happen when it comes to reducing trade deficit. Raising interest rate can attract an inflow of savings from overseas and reducing borrowing by consumers which they might otherwise spend on import. So when they increase the level of interest rate, people will go and put their money into the bank. So they will get a higher return on income on the deposit they have made. So they will not spend on imports again. Trade barriers can be used to restrict imported goods. So they will stop the level of imported goods into the country. They can put a quota. Quota means like the level of products should not come to the country. They will set a range of product which should not come to the country, and they will set a range of this much of product should not come into the country. Maybe 100,000 goods, 200,000 goods. They will set a limit in number. So that will limit the level of products coming into the country, or they will restrict that particular country. This country cannot bring the product at all to the country inside. So allow the exchange rate to depreciate. Why do they depreciate? If your currency's value goes down. Now you might not know what is depreciation, so I'll explain you what is depreciation very soon. There are two things you need to understand, depreciation and appreciation. What is depreciation? Depreciation says that if I compare with my country's value, now you guys know we are in Sri Lanka. So Sri Lanka and dollar, if I'm going to take the dollar, USD, okay, dollar. So Sri Lanka is having LKR and dollar. So if one dollar is equal to, I'm going to take if $1 is equal to 200 rupees LKR, we said as depreciation, not depreciation, it's the normal value I'm going to take. I'm going to show how depreciation works, guys. Now I'm going to take depreciation, $1 is equal to 250, we said as depreciation. And what is appreciation? Because the money value has decreased. What is appreciation? Appreciation means $1 is equal to 280. Why does it become appreciation? Earlier, you spent a very less amount to buy the a particular product appreciation. Now you need to spend a lot of money to spend on purchasing a product. If appreciation happens, people will feel now, okay, earlier it was 200 rupees to buy a product. Now it's just 180 and they will purchase a lot. That's not good for a country. So appreciation and depreciation should be always balanced. But the moment they depreciate the currency, this product, what they were buying at 200, now it's 250. So people will stop buying the product because it's too costly for them to afford. So depreciation will reduce the level of import, but producers will get motivated. If they can sell the product to outside country, they can get a higher return on income. So they will get motivated because earlier when they said they got 200, but now they are getting 250, and they will start to export as much as possible. This will increase the level of export and reduce the level of import, turning to reduction in trade deficit. And what they are trying to say on the next part, a large deficit will cause foreign exchange rate of national currency to fall. And as I said, that there's a large deficit, the foreign exchange rate of national currency to fall. As we said, the depreciation will take place without willing, this will take place because when we are relying on the imports, that import people also try to increase their demand, and they will increase the prices of the product, and we should pay a higher price for the product what we were paying earlier. Imports will become more expensive, but exports will be cheaper for overseas consumers to buy, because earlier they spent, if there's a trade deficit, as I said, they might be going through a time where the people cannot buy the imports at a smaller rate. It will become expensive. But what happened? Export will become cheaper for overseas consumers to buy. Why is that? When money value of the particular country is decreasing, people will be able to afford and purchase the product at any cost they have. Now, if you take USA, you might see imports will become more expensive, but exports will become cheaper for overseas consumers too. But how come imports will become more expensive? I'll explain you through this. You can see my Excel sheet. Now, if you see here, $1, earlier it was 200. Now $1 is 250. It has got depreciated. So earlier, if I go with $1, 250, I need to spend 0.04 only. But if I go with $1 to 180 in appreciation point, they need to spend 0.005 cents to purchase my product. But now just they wanted to spend 0.004. So before if it is in appreciation, they spend a higher amount to buy the product. If it's in depreciation, they are spending a less amount than the amount, because if I take 556 also, if I make it into the same value 0.005, or it will come 0.006. So spending 0.006 is costlier than spending 0.004. If when the country is going through trade deficit, the other country people will spend a very less amount than these countries, than the amount they were paying earlier. So let's move on to the point we want to discuss. As consumer demand for import falls and overseas demand for export rise, the trade deficit will disappear. As people, when import is increasing, the values are increasing, people will not buy import, and what happens, the producers will try to sell the products as much as possible to outside country. So the export of the country will increase, and the demand for that particular country's product will increase within the country itself. So aggregate demand will increase, disappearing the level of trade deficit. So if you have a question tomorrow or in your exams, if you find how to reduce trade deficit, these are the ways they can use: contraction of fiscal policy, raise interest rate, trade barriers, allow exchange rate to depreciate, large deficit will cause exchange rate to fall, imports will become expensive, consumer demand for import falls. So speak about these points. Let's move on to the next part then. Exchange rate is the price of a country's currency in terms of another country's currency. I have seen this type of definition has been asked most of the time. What is exchange rate? They have asked in all the exam papers. So you need to know the actual definition. Is the price of country's currency in terms of another country's currency. As I showed you, LKR and dollar, that the currency you are comparing with another country's currency. Most countries have a floating exchange rate, which means no set value for their currency compared with any other currency. Currency is a commodity, thus the value of a currency is totally dependent on demand and supply of that currency in the foreign exchange market. An appreciation in the value of currency means its exchange rate against other country has risen. A depreciation in the value of currency means its exchange rate against other countries have fallen. Now you need to understand what is floating exchange rate first of all. In floating exchange rate, there is no limit that the currency should be in 250. It can go to, the currencies now I'm going to take these currencies value. It was earlier, it was 200. Now it was the stable rate. Unfortunately, it went to 250 and it was depreciated. And unfortunately, it went to 180, it got appreciated. There's no possibility of controlling the floating amount of money. So floating exchange rate speaks something about. So this floating exchange rate says that the currency's value will go up and down. It's not stable. The exchange rate cannot be controlled and maintained. Now let's look onto the topic. It's just remember these things. That's more than enough. Exchange rate fluctuation. Now what happens when exchange rate increases and decreases? As you remember, as I spoke about floating exchange rate, there's something else called fixed exchange rate. Here the currency value doesn't go up and down. They set a price, 200 is the price they're going to demand, and this is the price they're going to exchange. Now, what's the good thing in fixed exchange rate? They can forecast the level of profit. For example, if the country says that we are going to pay only 200 rupees for any amount, if the dollar rate increases or decreases, we are going to spend 200 rupees. The good thing is, even if the country gets depreciated, you can still buy the item at 200 rupees. The bad thing is, if the country gets appreciated, you can't buy at 180, you should buy at 200. So when other firms are buying at a lower cost, you will buy it at a higher cost. So fixed exchange rate has goods as well as cons. As well as when there's a floating exchange rate, you will go through depreciation as well as appreciation. When appreciation happens, it's good, you can buy it at a cheaper rate. When there's depreciation, you can't buy imports at a cheaper rate. That might be a problem to floating exchange rate. Now let's move on to the next part of this. Exchange rate fluctuation says that demand for a currency comes from foreign money flowing into the country. If demand rises, the currency's value will rise in relation to the other currency. Supply of the currency comes from domestic money flowing out of the country. If supply rises, the currency value will fall. So now, what does this demand and supply speaks about currency rate fluctuations? Now, if I say again, demand for a currency comes from foreign money flowing into the country. So if money flows into the country, your demand for money increases because you want more money to the country in order to increase the level of your currency's value. So if demand rises, the currency's value will rise. So more money coming into the country, your currency's value will rise. Again, it will lead towards appreciation. Supply of currency comes from domestic money flowing out of the country. You invest your money outside the country, then if supply increases, the currency's value will fall. So this is meant by, so supply increases, depreciation happens, demand increases for currency, appreciation might happen. So you need to be very careful on those terms. It can be tested in MCQ as well. A currency might depreciate because and currency might appreciate because I have given certain things. I'll quickly revise on these particular areas. There's a balance of payment deficit. Demand for other currencies rises as domestic consumers buy more imports. Interest rates fall related to other countries. People move their savings to bank account overseas. Inflation rises related to other countries. This makes exports more expensive and demand for them and the currency needed to buy them falls. People speculate that their currency will fall in the value and they sell their holdings of currency. So why a currency depreciates? There are a few reasons they have given. One is the country is having a trade balance deficit, which means our imports are higher than the export. Second thing, our consumers are relied on so much in import. So then you will spend a lot of money in import. Then of course your country will go through a depreciation. Interest rates falls related to other countries. Now you will not get a high return of income for the money you have invested in bank. So you will take that money and you will go and invest in overseas bank because people move their money to overseas bank. Then what happens, why people doesn't keep money in our country? The reason, the country's inflation has increased. So if people keep the money in our country, they will not get a high return. They will spend those money again on a different country and they will reduce the level of spending in our country. So they will not produce any products to the whole market. So exports will decrease on the market. Just remember these points. Then people speculate. People think that, in future, because people are spending in import, in future, the money value will go down. So let's give the currency to outside. How can they sell their currency holdings to other country? Because if they can exchange that currency on a different country, they will get some sort of income. How do we say that? People speculate that the currency will fall in value and they sell their holdings of the currency. Holding of the currency is not about selling the money what they have. They sell all the securities, they sell all the shares, and they will invest in a different country because they will try to take the investment what they have made in the country. Then we move on to appreciate. Why an appreciation happens? There's balance of payment surplus. Demand for the currency rises as overseas consumers buy more export. Interest rates rise related to other countries. They attract savings from overseas residents. Inflation is lower than in other countries, so exports will be cheaper. And overseas demand for them and the currency required to pay for them will rise. People speculate that the currency will rise in value and they buy more of the currency. Now again, when I speak about why currency gets appreciated, there's a payment balance of payment surplus. Currency is see that the country's export has increased, so country is earning a lot. And country's interest rate is very stable. People can invest and get a higher return. Country is trying to keep the inflation as low as possible. If the inflation is low as possible, stability of the price will be there. So people from other countries will invest. And people think that investing in this country is the right thing and they will invest more into the country. This will lead towards appreciation. So knowing these terms are very important when you're doing a paper two in the exams. Okay, then we move on to the next part, trade protection. Moving on to the point we want to discuss now, trade protection. Trade protection are the way of stopping the level of imports coming into the country. What are the ways they're going to stop the level of products which is coming into the country? The first way, tariff, is the tax, a direct tax on imports, to raise its price and make them more expensive than local goods to stop people buying them. The moment they have put a tariff, the people's product will go up and people will not buy the product, and that products will not be purchased by others because tariff is too much. Okay, so tariffs means it's about imposing a price on any product which is coming into the country. They limit the level of products which is coming into the country by just charging a level of tax on the products. Then we move on to next part, subsidies. Grant given to an industry by government, so industry will lower its prices, encouraging consumers to stop buying foreign imports by making home produced goods cheaper. Why a government gives grants? If government gives grants, people, you know, domestic industry will feel motivated to produce. Government is giving you a free land, government is giving a free building, and they will take that particular place they will produce it rather than rely on import. So subsidies will increase the level of export to the market, reducing the level of import. Quota, as I said, it will limit the number of imports allowed into a country per year, reducing quantity of imports without changing the price. So they will limit the number of quantities coming into the country. Maybe if you take 100,000 quantity, they will allow only 50,000, 20,000 quantities every year when you bring the product. This will limit the level of imports coming into the country, again making it very hard for the products to enter the country. Embargo, complete ban on imports of certain goods. And embargo may be used to stop imports of drugs, cigarettes, alcohol. Certain countries, they have even stopped, like countries like Israel, they don't have cigarettes at all. So why they have banned cigarettes? The reason, they wanted to completely ban certain goods which is coming into the country. They want to stop and they want to improve their country's economy. So they will try to limit the level of production coming to the country. So that's what we say, embargo. Then we move on to the next part. So we have learned few things of trade protection, tariffs, subsidies, quota, and embargo. Learn these terms very carefully. Then what are the merits of free trade? Free trade means there's no taxes, guys. You can bring the goods without taxes into the country. We say that's free trade. So bringing the product without taxes to a country, we say that's what trade. Free trade. Why? What are the good things for a consumer of having a free trade? Cheaper products, better products, workers more productive, international trade, increased competition from international market, lower prices, better qualities. So how about merit for free trade? Cheaper products, they can buy at a lower cost because no taxes. Better products, they can buy the product than producing the product. Workers more productive, when they bring the technology, new technology to the country, people will work very fast. International trade will have a good type of bond between other countries. Increased competition from international companies. When companies' products have been purchased from different countries, all these companies will compete, try to satisfy our country's people. Lower prices, better quality. As many companies are fighting to sell the product, you will get good price and good quality. But to producers, it's a very big market. They can achieve economies of scale. And economies of scale means higher reduction in production cost. An increase in sales, that's what you say, economies of scale. More produce, lower average per unit cost. So more produce, lower average per unit cost means the more you produce, the average cost will decrease. Average cost means total cost divided by the number of outputs. International trade increases number of products you make. So as you are producing a lot, you can sell it to different markets. So you can actually connect the whole market and get the market. A market, you can get the use of the entire market easily. Then we have to governments, why a government should have a free trade? Export increase jobs, GDP, income. So when it comes to, if you can allow the product coming into the country, you can also sell the product to other countries. It will increase the level of jobs because domestic industries will give employment opportunities to people. And if you increase the GDP, gross domestic product, output of the country will come, will increase. When output of the country increases, people will have enough income. So people's income will also increase. That will also increase the level of living standard of people in the country. But imports will take them away. But imports take them away. When people have income, they will spend on imports most of the time. So that will reduce the level of income what they have earned. That's what they have meant. So then we move on to next part, protection. Arguments for protection and arguments against. So let's see why a protection is very important for a country. Protection of a young industry to prevent unemployment, to prevent dumping. Because other countries use barriers to trade to prevent over-specialization. So what is the protection of young industry? If you want to save some companies which is going to emerge in a few years of time as a big industry, if you allow other countries to come and do trade, your country's companies cannot survive because those companies will be kicked out of the market. To prevent unemployment, why to prevent unemployment? like if these companies from outside come into our country, they will bring their country people and they will be giving job opportunities. So our country people will not get job opportunities. To prevent dumping, dumping means, you need to understand the term dumping very clearly. Dumping means if they cannot sell the outdated product in their country, that country will send all the outdated product into a country. For example, I'm just taking another example. If USA cannot sell Tommy Hilfiger in their market, they will send to Sri Lanka to sell the, maybe 20 years later the product comes into the country. They can't sell that whole ton of product, so they will dump that product into our country. So when they dump this product into the country, people will buy saying that, wow, it's Tommy Hilfiger, it's very big price. Okay, give me a second. Dumping means like when this product comes into the country, in Sri Lanka, they'll be like, wow, this is an awesome product, and they will start purchasing that product saying that it's a good product. But actually, they sold an outdated product to the country. So selling an outdated product is not good. You need to exchange into the market state. So you need to take buy quality products, not bad quality products on the market. So it says that then we have, so dumping, some countries even dump their garbage into the country, bringing multinational companies, and they will dump all the bad things into the country, like garbage, unnecessary stuff, they can't waste there. So what they will do, they will try to do it in our country. Then they have, because of other countries use barriers to trade, now other countries might limit. Now Sri Lanka has a problem. Sri Lanka can bring the product from China, but Sri Lanka cannot sell the product to China. So it is one of an unfair way of doing agreements, but still the country is doing some sort of trading. So it's not good actually. To prevent over-specialization, if people are producing one particular thing and they are better in producing one particular thing, they will rely on that particular thing and they will focus, and other industries will try to come and take over the whole market. People will only produce one thing. Now, example, if you take Saudi is good for petrol, they will only do petrol, they will not do other industries. So education industry, finance industry, all will go down in that particular country. So that's arguments for, arguments against why protection should be not be made, why protectionism is not important to a country. Other countries will retaliate with trade barriers. The moment you put protectionism, other countries also will say that, hey, you know, if you are putting protection, we are not going to do trade with you. It protects inefficient domestic firms. When you put protectionism and you don't bring the other country's product, sometimes when you want to save your country's product, your domestic firms are not that quality wise best to sell the products towards the market. The loss of domestic jobs from overseas comparison will only be temporary. So, when these companies come and they emerge, they might hire the people from their own country, but that will be only for temporary. After some time, they will recruit our staff also. So that is a very bad assumption that those countries' people only will come and survive here. Trade barriers have increased the gap between rich and poor countries. So actually, if you are a poor country and you don't allow a rich country to come inside, of course, your country still will go poor because you will not be able to produce the product in an efficient manner. So I hope you understood the content number 8. 8 content, I have given you a clear explanation about international aspects. So let's move on to the next part.